Hello, I'm Graham and I hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to this brand new set of tutorials helping users transition from the Panasonic Lumix FZ200 to the new FZ330. Now I know in some parts of the world it's referred to as the FZ300, but for the purpose of this video tutorial I'm just going to call it the FZ330 or the 330. The video series is designed to help you emulate on the 330 all the features that you've been using so consistently on the FZ200. In this video introduction, we're going to look at the camera itself, some of the new changes that have been made to the 330. Then we'll look at emulating my favourite setup for the FZ200, which, as you know if you're a follower of my channel, is to shoot in aperture priority mode, use the sweet spot of the lens around about f4, and use the native base ISO of ISO 100. There are very few situations which I will vary from that situation, and I'm going to use exactly the same with the 330, and I've developed some settings which seem to work fine for me. Let's get started. Let's have a look at the 330 and see what the differences are. Well, first of all, you might notice it has a slightly bigger camera and it's a little bit heavier. There's also a change to the lens hood, so if you are using the 200 and the 330, be aware that the 200 lens hood has got a much deeper petal than on the 330. Now, whether that's something to do with the flash on the 330, maybe it was casting too much of a shadow on the lower part of the picture, I'm not exactly certain, but be aware there are changes to the lens petal. All your accessories will work with the 330 that you've used on the 200, so your things like your Raynox macro close-up lenses, individual filters that are 52mm thread, wide-angle lenses like this Digital Pro, which has got a 52mm thread, they will all work, as well as the LA7 extension tube and the LT55 telephoto conversion lens. Flash accessories are exactly the same, like this Nissan i40 is totally compatible with the 330, plus some new features of the flash circuitry in the 330 allows us to use the flash much more intelligently. It will also work with the pop-up diffuser that I've been recommended. If you are using the pop-up flash, it will still fit and not interfere with the Cobra head. So all the accessories are covered. Let's have a look at the camera itself. One of the biggest changes is the battery compartment and SD card slot. Now the battery box opens up to the front of the camera, allowing you access to the battery and the SD card whilst the camera's on a tripod if you use an Arca plate. It is very tight. There's only about a millimeter difference between the hinge cover and the Arca plate, but you can get it to fit and use this on a tripod and remove your SD card or your battery while it's on there. So that is a great feature that I'm glad they've improved on. When we're talking about batteries and SD cards, it's the same battery as the FZ200, it's the BLC12E. So if you've got existing batteries, either the original equipment manufacturers or third party, if they're BLC12E, then they will work with this device. If you power up the camera, you'll notice that it says insert memory card. Unlike the FZ200, which has sufficient internal memory for you to shoot 13 full res 12 megapixel images, the FZ330 doesn't have any inbuilt memory that you can use. So with every situation where you want to take pictures, you're going to have to install a memory card. Quite often I've been out with the FZ200 and left the memory card in the card reader on my PC, but I've been able to get away with the fact that I can get 12 pictures, and maybe that was enough for a day shoot, I don't know. But there you are, you can get some internal shots with the FZ200, you're not going to get that luxury with the FZ330. Let's have a look at the memory card requirements themselves. If you're going to shoot photos only, then you only need a class 2, 4 or 6 card, it really doesn't matter. If you're going to shoot full HD or MP4 video, then you need a class 6 card. So that's the old rating, the SDHC, class 4 or class 6 will be fine for AVC, HD or MOV. If you are going to contemplate shooting 4K, then the 4K video codec in this camera produces a file with 100 megabits per second bitrate. Divide that by 8 to get the megabytes, and that's about 12 megabytes. So you need a card that's capable of consistently writing at 12 megabits per second. But remember, the 100 megabits per second is the absolute maximum that's delivered from the codec when it's being fully stressed. So if you've got a very highly dense resolution picture, then you will need the 100 megabits to resolve all that detail. If it's a plain scene with lots of plain backgrounds, it's nowhere near 100 megabits per second, and you can get away with a low bitrate card. If you are going to be shooting 4K video, I do recommend that you get one of the UHS Class 1 cards, and they guarantee a minimum write speed of 10 megabytes per second. And that's the minimum write speed, so they will probably be a lot faster than that and will probably serve very well with the FZ330 in full UHD video, 4K video. If you want to be absolutely certain that you're not going to get any write errors with the camera, then look for the new UHS Class 3 cards, and they're guaranteed at 30 megabytes per second, which is far in excess of what you need with this camera, but it does guarantee that you're not going to get any write problems. So look for the UHS 3 in the U symbol on the card, as I'm showing you on screen now. I want now to start to look at setting up the FZ330 as I would the FZ200 for my favourite scenario. So we have aperture priority, f4 as the lens aperture, ISO 100 as the native ISO, and I use the AFS single area mode for my focusing. That allows me to define the size and position of the focus target depending on the actual scene type. So I want to be able to set that up on the 330. On the FZ200, remember, we could get a shortcut to that by just pressing the focus button on the side of the camera, and that brought up the focus target on the back of the screen, and then we could use the navigation buttons to set the position, and we could use the back control dial to set the size. It's not quite that easy with the FZ330, but I'm going to show you a couple of techniques to enable you to do just as quick. Okay, let's have a look at the back of the camera and look at some of those menus. By default, the camera is set up to use this new 49 area focus method. So if I depress the shutter button halfway down, you'll notice the number of rectangles that appear to show the area in focus are far more than on the 23 area of the FZ200. What I want to do is now change this to the autofocus single area rather than this 49 area. To do that, first of all, we're going to depress this button here, the left-hand navigation button, and that brings up the menu to enable us to change the autofocus mode. And I want to skip across to get to the single area mode. Once you've done that, press menu set. That will now change the focus area from 49 points to a single point. And now if I half depress the shutter button, you notice that we only get the single target, which is the one in the centre of the screen, coming up in green, which indicates we've got a focus point. To change the position, again, you would use the same left-hand navigation button. And now we would use the down cursor to set the area that we require. So if I now press the down button, it allows me to change the position and the size of that autofocus area. So for example, if I wanted this point of the image to be in focus, I can move its position across by using the four-way navigation key, and I can move it down. If I wanted to change the size, then I'll use the top control dial. This is the new top control dial, which replaces the back control dial that was on the FZ200. So by using the top control dial, I can make that very small, or I can make it quite large. Once you've done that, press menu set to lock that value in. So now when I half depress the shutter button, you'll notice that the green rectangle is the size that we defined in that setup. There is an additional pinpoint mode. So if we go into that menu again and I come across to the right hand side, this is a new pinpoint autofocus method. So it uses a very, very fine area, much smaller than the smallest area you can set with the single area autofocus method. So again, if I wanted to define the position of that, press the down key, and that allows me now to set the target, which is that center cross point on the image. So if you really want to set fine focus points, you use the pinpoint method. And again, just press menu set, and that locks it in, and you notice the cursor has changed to a four-way head with the cross in the center, and it's that will determine the focus point. So I depress the shutter button now, you'll see that that's going to be the single point of focus. So that method might be all right if you want to just use the two button depresses. So you'll go
left to access the menu, and then down to change the size and position. I'm now going to show you a method of programming the F4 key so that we can do that exactly the same way as we did with FZ200 by pushing the side focus button. To do that, we need to go into the menu to allow us to program the function buttons. So if I go into the menu and we go into the custom setup, which is this one here on the left hand side, it's the spanner icon with a C for custom setup. And if you scroll down, you will find the facility to program function button set on page 7. So when you press the menu set button, that brings up the option to set the buttons in the record mode or the buttons in the play mode. So you've got two features of operation and you can assign different buttons to different functions either in the record or in the play mode. So we're going to set the record mode, so press menu set, and now it brings up a complete picture of all the function buttons on the camera. So you've got function 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now the 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9 are actually on the touch panel. The physical buttons are 1, 2, 3 and 4. So to program function button 4, I can either use the navigation buttons to get down to function 4, or I can use the touchscreen that's enabled on this camera. So using my stylus, I just need to touch function button 4, and that brings me straight into the menu which will set that function button. I can now choose the function that's going to be assigned to that particular function button. And if you notice here on the top of the screen, it's saying function 4 button set. At the moment it's assigned to LVF and monitor, I want to scroll through until we see focus area set. Once you've done that, press the menu set button, and you can now see confirmed on the screen that that is function area set. And if I now come out of the menu by pressing the shutter button, if I now depress function button 4, you can see it has brought up my target area that I defined in the screen previously. And again, I can change the size and position by using the cursor keys, left or right, up and down, and I can change the size of it by using the top control dial. If I wanted to go back to single area method rather than the pinpoint, again, I would use the cursor key to switch over to single area, press menu set, then I could press function 4, and that would give me the option to now set the size and the position of that focus target. There is a facility with the electronic viewfinder that when you bring it up to your eye, it starts to focus for you immediately, so it can save valuable time in getting the subject into sharp focus. If you're finding the sensitivity of your viewfinder is too high, if it's triggering even though you've not got your eye to the camera, then you can actually change its sensitivity by going to the eye sensor on page 9 of the settings menu, and you can change the sensitivity from high to low. And now we'll just check the function of the autofocus start when you bring the camera up to your eye. And again, it's in the custom set menus. And if I scroll through, eye sensor autofocus is on. If you don't want the camera to focus when you bring the camera to your eye, then of course you can just turn that off. Finally, there is another way of defining the focus point, and that's to use the touchscreen. So for example, if I wanted to set the focus over onto the left-hand close-up lens, then by using my stylus, I can just touch the screen and that will bring the focus point over to this side. And you can just notice behind my stylus, the cursor is following the stylus. So I can position that anywhere on the screen that I want that focus point to be. If I release the stylus, then I can either change its size by using the top control dial, or just as with a smartphone, you can use your fingers to pinch and expand to change the size of the target. So I'll simulate that by just using my two thumbs. I'm going to just press on the screen and pull my thumbs apart. And you can see I can change the focus target, and you can do that with two fingers on the screen to change the focus target, and you can actually change the position of it with your thumb or finger if you wanted to. So there's three ways that you can change the autofocus single area point to exactly where you need it to be on the screen. There is another method of directly setting the focus area, but that means losing the functionality of the four-way navigation button, and it's called Direct Focus Area Select. If we go into the menu, and again if we scroll through, Direct Focus Area is currently set off, and that's on page 3 of the custom setup menu. If we turn that to on, with Direct Focus Area set to on, it means that the four-way navigation dial controls the position of the focus point. So if I wanted to move to the right-hand side, all I have to do is move the cursor to the right-hand side, and you can see that it directly changes the position of the target. So down if I wanted to go down, and up if I wanted to go up. And if I wanted to change the size, then as before, I can use my touch sensor screen, or I can use a top control dial to set that size of point. To take the shot, obviously, halfway down to get the focus point, then take the picture. Unfortunately, that means that we've lost access to the facility to set things like the self timer or white balance control or the ISO. So you need to set those by using the quick menu, otherwise you can't get access to them. If I did want to change ISO, then I have to use the quick menu. So if I go into quick menu, then I need to scroll into the operation and change the ISO to what I needed. I think the loss of functionality of the four-way navigation dial is too much of a sacrifice when you can actually use one of the other function keys, such as function 4, to give access to setting that direct focus area and not lose this functionality. We're in the aperture priority mode, and you can see that being indicated at the top left hand side of the screen by the A. Unlike the FZ200, when we rotate the top control dial, we don't get an animated display of what's happening. It just changes the icon in the top left hand side. So if you're looking for shutter priority, just turn the dial until you see S. It means in the dark you can see which mode you're in, rather than having to use a torch to illuminate the top control dial. So I'm in aperture priority mode. I want to set an aperture of f4. So directly now the top control dial is controlling the aperture. So if I can turn the dial to the right, you'll notice that it brings up the exposure meter, which is on by default. And then I can set up aperture of f4. If we don't want the exposure meter to be on, then we can turn that off again in the custom setup menu. If I scroll through until we get to page 6, there's the exposure meter. It's set to on by default. Turn that off, and it doesn't clutter up the screen when you're setting the aperture. So now I can change my aperture, and it's not being affected by the exposure meter. So there I've got F4. The camera's on intelligent ISO. So when I have to press the shutter button, the camera calculates the exposure, which is 1/80 of a second. The camera set, if you look, when we take the picture, an ISO of 1000. If I wanted to be in control of the ISO, then obviously press the ISO and change the value by using the top control dial or the navigation buttons. So I've set a value of 100, press menu set, and now you can see locked onto the display ISO 100, much the same way as you would have or the FZ200. So with an ISO set of 100, an aperture of 4, when I have to press the shutter button, you can see it's calculated an exposure time of 1/60 of a second, and you can see that on the bottom of the display. If I wanted to apply some exposure value compensation because the subject brightness is different to the background, then remember on the FZ200 we use the back control dial and push that in to give access to the EV scale. With this camera, then the first operation is to press the function 1 button, and function 1 brings up the exposure value compensation. So I can now use the top control dial to change exposure value compensation, and it goes the direction that you want it to go. So I'm going to the right, I'm going to increase the exposure value compensation. I'm going to the left to decrease the exposure value compensation. So for example, in a snow scene or a beach scene, you're going to be using positive exposure value compensation to accommodate the change in brightness. You notice that the icons are indicated by the control wheel. So this one is the top control wheel and this is the side control wheel. And if I wanted to change the flash exposure compensation, I can change that by using the side wheel on the camera, and that gives me the access to that without going into a secondary menu. So that's exposure value compensation and how to set it with the FZ330. If I wanted to use the camera on a tripod and use the self-timer to initiate the exposure, then if I press the self-timer button, which is the bottom position of the four-way navigation key, if I press that down, it brings up the drive mode select. And I can now select either the burst modes, the exposure bracketing, or the delay for the self-timer. So if I scroll across to the 10-second mode, I can either use the navigation buttons, I can use the top control dial, or I can use a stylus to touch the 10-second. If I wanted that to be 2 seconds, then you see we've got an option here that says more settings. So if I touch that with a stylus or I use the up arrow key, you can see that I've now got 10 seconds or 3 exposures with 10 seconds between, or a 2-second timer. So if I want the 2-second timer, I just depress that, and you can see now if I depress the button, it's got set up for a 2-second timer. So now when I start the exposure, we get the usual 2-second countdown and then take the picture. To cancel that, then just go into the menu again and go over to the left hand side and reset everything to single. With the FZ330, the self timer is locked even if it goes into hibernation or you turn off the power. If you want it to reset when the camera is powered down, then you can change that in the self-timer auto off menu. And you'll find that in the standard setup screen, and it's on page 5, I think. Page 4, self-timer auto off. If you set that to on, then that retains the value. If you set it to off, it forgets the value when you turn off the camera. By default, the function 2 button gives you access to ISO and white balance, so it saves you having to go to the four-way navigation buttons to get it. One depress of the function 2 button, the side control dial changes the white balance, and the top control dial would change the ISO. But again, if you wanted to change the functionality of function 2 button, you can program that to any one of something like 44 different commands that are available with the camera.
So that's it for this first introductory video. I hope you found some of those points interesting. In my next video, we'll cover the AFC, the autofocus continuous mode, and the AFF mode. And we'll look at setting up manual focus on this camera. And it's far easier to set up manual focus than it was with the FZ200, which was frankly quite a bit of a joke and very impossible to set fine focus. You had to set a rough focus and then rock the camera backwards and forwards to get the exact focus point. With the FZ330, we now have the facility of a fine wheel on the side, which can set that focus a lot more accurately. So until my next video, do check out my photographic blog if you've not seen it before, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. There'll be much more of a write-up on the setup of this 330 camera on that photographic blog. If you are a new viewer to this video and you haven't subscribed, please do click that subscribe button, and then you'll be notified in your subscription list when I upload any more videos in this series. So until my next video, it's Graham saying thanks for watching, please do take care, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye for now.